The fields of social responsibility and philanthropy are growing rapidly in the Arab world and their communities in the diaspora. Until recently, there was a dearth of theoretical and applied research, and most scholars and professionals worked in relative isolation. TECAFO, the annual conference on Arab philanthropy and civic engagement, encourages scholars, policymakers, and practitioners to engage in an intellectual exchange grounded in theory and practice, and promoting best practice and data-based policymaking. And joining us this morning to shed more light on TECAFO 2012 is Dr. Baza Ibrahim, director at the Jerhad Center at the American University in Cairo. Thank you so much for being with us this morning.
Great to be here.
And a very good morning to you, Doctor. Well, indeed, the center is a leading provider of knowledge and resources to strengthen this idea of philanthropy and civic practice in the Arab world. Can you tell us a little bit about the tools used for the center to spread this knowledge?
Well, I think we have to admit that civic participation and citizenship, as of 2 years ago, was not a concept that people really understood very much. So we would say civic engagement, and people would say, you mean couples getting engaged. They didn't really understand about what are the tools of citizenship. So we work a lot with students. We think that that's the next generation of Democrats that are going to build their societies in this part of the world. And we work on soft skills, how to communicate and persuade, how to really listen to another side of an argument, and how to organize for change. Because if we think about it, after the revolution of 18 days, the missing piece from then on was citizens organizing to really build the society that they want to see. And we think we all have a role in doing that.
Okay. Is the work of the Gerhard Center confined to the American University's community?
Not at all. We do a lot of work with our own students, and we test out ideas that work, like changing a course content so that our students are out in communities while they're learning. And then we work with Egyptian national universities. We've built an alliance where the presidents of Arab universities make a commitment that they want their universities to be more civically engaged, and we work on tools and outreach with them. A lot of our programs are regional. So one of my staff members was in Libya just a few months after their revolution finished to see what was going on in the field of philanthropy. How were citizens putting their resources to work to rebuild? And we have a scan now of research on that.
Mm-hmm. And the idea of work on a regional basis is very important indeed, especially that the entire Arab world has been going through this democratic change and experience of the Arab Spring. TECAFO is one of those activities undertaken by the center. We want to learn more about it, especially that we know that the annual conference is starting in very soon, right? It's next month, I guess, you've got the
That's right.
conference?
That's right. This is an annual gathering, as far as we know, the first in the region. Scholars were studying what's changing in our region, but they were doing it in pockets of isolation. Practitioners are trying to figure out how to build civil society, but they often feel a bit lonely. And then you have policymakers who really are at a loss. What do we do about youth in the new Egypt? What do we do about reforming Al-Qaf? How do we rebuild philanthropy that people can believe in and participate in? So we bring all these actors together once a year for 3 days. They listen to empirical research so that there's some grounding in facts. But then we talk a lot about how to make change happen.
Mm-hmm. Okay, what about the idea of convening the conference? Did it emerge before or after the revolution?
We had this idea before, and so the first one was in the planning stages when January 25th happened. We held the first one in Jordan. It was an incredible success because it was in April of 2011, and everyone wanted to hear about the Arab Spring and the role of citizens and young people. Our partner in that was Columbia University's Middle East Research Center, and it was, you know, it exceeded our expectations. This year we're bringing it home to Egypt. We have a lot more representation from North Africa this time around. We have some amazing speakers. One of the human rights leaders from Tunisia will open the conference. And we'd like to encourage anyone who's interested to join us.
So before we speak about the upcoming event, tell us about the first conference. How successful was it? Did you come up with concrete outcomes, results, maybe a short of how civic practice has changed after the revolutions in the Arab world?
I think what it brought home to all of us is how many young scholars are out there doing really good work. So an entire session on faith and giving with some really good papers about Hezbollah, for example, and what is the social side of what they do as well as the political side. There were papers that examined how youth were shifting from the politics of the street to the practice of civic engagement in their communities. So that was a really nice discovery for all of us. There's a volume of the very best of the papers that we've circulated. It's available online at the Gerhardt Center AUC website. And this year, I think it's going to be even bigger and even better.
So talking about the first conference, was it confined to deliberations, exchanging experience, exchanging researches, or did you go a step farther by taking recommendation or putting forward recommendations to be applied on the ground?
I think our first conference fell short on that. We were focusing on getting some facts together and letting people understand that policy isn't made in a vacuum. If you don't know what's really happening in your societies, then your policies and your laws will come out of thin air. But if we understand that philanthropy that used to be wealthy people doing things and getting close to the first family to do them is shifting, you know, before our very eyes, and it's now much more about ordinary people putting their resources together with ideas and time and talent to see the changes they want on the ground. If we understand that, then our policy will look very different. So I think you'll find this year, on June 10th to 12th at AUC, much more of a, as you say, concrete recommendations and thinking together about what has to change.
So tell us a little bit more about the issues on the agenda for this second conference that is taking place here in Egypt. You've already mentioned that it is outcome-oriented in a way. Can you give us more details about it?
Some of the sessions will focus on gender. We've all had, you know, enough of a wake-up call, I think, over the last year, that issues around women in our part of the world are going to be contested ground as we go through our transitions. So an entire session is going to be devoted to the place of women and citizenship in the new Arab world. We have some great papers and some really, I think, important discussions on that topic. Another is to think about our traditions. The Arab world is one of the most giving, generous cultures in the world. But a lot of our institutions were old and tired. Zakat needed to be rethought in terms of modern life. Al-Khaf was nationalized under Nasser and actually banned. How do we revive those the way Turkey has, the way Indonesia has, so that people can take their personal beliefs and act on them in a way that changes society for the better? So I think you'll see a lot of those kind of topics coming up.
And do you intend to make the outcome of these discussions and deliberations online, for example, for ordinary people to get to know what has been talked about during the conference? I mean, to benefit researchers, to professional students?
Absolutely. Everything we do at the Gerhardt Center is online and open access, and these papers will also be available. And it's really interesting, you know, corporates are also one of the key actors right now. And we're finding that when they get involved along with communities and along with researchers that can evaluate the impact of what's happening on the ground, that's a kind of three-way cooperation that also really helps to make things happen.
Mm-hmm. I want to go back to the idea that you have mentioned about women. You know, of course, that philanthropy in a way have a religious dimension, like you've mentioned with the zakat and waqf. And we know that Arab societies are by nature religious societies. So do you think that this is an item that comes to enhance this spirit of philanthropic work? Or do you see that it could stand as an obstacle on certain topics like the issue of women, for instance, that you've also mentioned?
I'm really not concerned about that, because philanthropy is an impulse to give back. to feel that if I want to be a good Muslim or a good Christian, then I have to somehow help to build the good society. And that motivation is only good. The question comes with, how do you harness that impulse? If people think that giving some coins to a beggar fulfills their obligation, then we probably aren't going to see much change. Mm-hmm. But if they follow their gift and say, what's the impact? Am I being more strategic? Am I addressing a root cause of a problem instead of just putting a Band-Aid on its
symptom? But this is a whole conceptual change in the ideas of Egyptians or Arabs in general, don't you think so?
It's a big shift, but it's already underway. Mm-hmm. We could see it underway 2 years ago when we published the first book on philanthropy in 8 different Arab countries. After the revolutions and during this Arab Spring, there's more momentum, there's more questioning. What are the ethics of philanthropy? How transparent are we going to be, or is it all going to happen behind a curtain? Should the beneficiaries have a say about how the money is spent? These are the issues that are making it a really exciting field right now. An organization like Risala, mm-hmm. that has 100,000 youth volunteers in Egypt. Everyone pays £10 a month in that organization. 90% of the members are girls and women. So I think that's why I want to tell you that in the area of philanthropy, we think that the participation of girls and women is only for the better.
Mm-hmm.
Politics comes in, as you all know, when we start to think about the role of men and women in society. And so it becomes almost like a proxy for talking about other things. What is the freedom of the individual to choose? And it's the same with cops and Muslims. If we get to a point of thinking about citizenship, if I don't want to be harassed by the police, if I want my individual integrity to be respected, then I have to respect it for men and women. And people who believe differently than I do. So we're building this concept of citizenship as a way forward, as a way beyond
gender issues, beyond religious issues. So
that's right, mm-hmm. that's right. And if we're busy building the country we want to see, hopefully we can get beyond some of this.
Okay.
Accountability and transparency are two important elements when we talk about philanthropy. How successful are organizations, charity organizations in the region in securing the conditions for those two elements?
It's getting better. More and more philanthropies publish an annual report, so you'll know what they spent their money on, how much they spent, and increasingly they're starting to invest in evaluation. Did I make a difference with my giving? We still have a ways to go, but we're getting there. The good news for me is that 3 years ago you would have seen a bunching of philanthropy working on very traditional areas, orphans, the poor, employment opportunities, microcredit. That's good. But there are so many other areas where we had no or very little Arab giving. Human rights, refugees, ethnic relations.
Beyond the borders, you mean? Sometimes you need to go beyond
the
borders.
Exactly. And that's where I think you're going to see new dynamism. You're going to see young organizations formed by young people that are going to take on the difficult tasks.
But do you think it's up to such philanthropic initiatives and work to take on the social development process of a country? Shouldn't it be more of an integrated approach between all partners, all stakeholders? If yes, then how? How can we make that link and coordination?
I see civil society as the research laboratory. So we want civil society to test out what's working. They have the flexibility, the freedom, the money comes from the private sector. They can do things that governments cannot do. But when they have a model that works for bringing young girls in rural Egypt back into the education stream, that's when you want government to pick it up, to take it to scale, and to make it a public offering or a public service. So there's a role for both, and we can't get along without either. If we have a critique of the Nasser years, it would be that social contract was, you go home, don't get involved, don't worry yourself, and the government will provide. And we all know that there's nowhere in the world where that's going to work.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Barbara Ibrahim, Director at the Gerhard Center, American University in Cairo, thank you so much for being with us this morning.
I really enjoyed it.
Thank you very much. And right now we're going to take you on a bit of live news from around the world.